Good morning, everybody. It's very easy for most people who have to struggle, like Karishma and Varun, when they have to start from scratch. And they, Karishma and I have this conversation. We are MBBS batchmates, actually. So we keep venting on each other about our current scenarios. And her constant response to me is, you keep quiet. You have an existing practice. Your father is there for everything. I have nobody. I don't even have a receptionist today, as you could see in the picture. The thing is, whether you get into a family-run business or a practice, or also you have a chance to buy out a practice, which is a very common thing these days, because there are a lot of senior ophthalmologists whose children have not chosen to get into medicine. So there are many practices out there that you can buy, and I would actually urge you to consider that or approach people even if they don't show interest. Most senior ophthalmologists want their practice to go on. So if there is someone in your city who is practicing well but is senior, it's always a good idea to try and approach them to join them, and to always make sure that there's a transition between the two of you. It should not be an absolute, I've taken your clinic and bye-bye, because transition is the most important thing about joining an existing practice. And the pros obviously is that the patient volume already exists. Patients already know about the setup. At least the basic setup is already there. It may be a very, very basic setup. It could be just an OPD. It could be OPD with OT. It could be a five-floor practice if you're lucky to be born with a golden spoon in your mouth. And your staff is in place. And of course, you have a mentor and guide to guide you and hold your hand through the whole process. The challenges for me personally and for most people who are second and third generation practitioners or who have bought out a practice is that you are the biggest threat to every other practitioner in that practice if there are other practitioners. People tend to have fixed ideas because it's been running. Our practice is 30 years old. I joined 5 years ago. So people had been working there for 15 years, 20 years. And of course, my father had been there from the start. So they had a fixed way of working, a fixed way of writing. Everything was handwritten. Everything was manual. Everything was very informal. Our accounts are still to be transitioned onto, which I'm going to learn from Dr. Varun how to get that software. So it's updating and upgrading is actually very, very challenging. It's not easy that you just go into a practice and, oh, wow, everything is hunky-dory and every patient is looking at you and saying, oh, yes, do my cataract surgery. The reality is nobody wants you to do their cataract surgery. Now people ask, but doctor saab, aap hi karenge na? Or questions are like, doctor saab ka beta nahi tha. So these are typical mentalities that exist. They are a reality, and there's nothing that one can do about it. But the only thing you can do is you can be patient and you can stay out in it. You have to build trust. So you have to make relationships with your patients. You have to talk to them. They may not show you their eyes. They may not allow you to do their surgery. But if you just start talking to them and create a relationship, in 1 or 2 years, in 3 years, in the first year, if my father or anybody else was on leave, our OPD would be empty or I would have one patient. Now if he goes on leave, maybe 10% of the patients still say, nahi, hume sir ko hi dikhana hai. So that transition takes time and that trust building takes time. The other thing is authority and hierarchy is always an issue. So unfortunately, there are staff who will still not listen to me. There are staff who will, we applied for NABH last year. Luckily, we were lucky to get through with the pre-entry level. Staff doesn't want to change, doesn't want to learn what is as per regulation. So that is a challenge. So one is you have to sit down with the staff. You need to counsel them. You need to understand why they are having issues, you know, conforming to rules and regulations. So this is a big challenge for me. So like I was saying, the expectation of second generation practice versus the reality is everybody assumes that madam has come into practice, she's going to be like a pro like Alia Bhatt. But the reality is that there's also Tanisha Mukherjee who was second generation and didn't do very well. So the reality is that everyone cannot be an Alia Bhatt, and even if you do, it takes time. Transition, like I said, is a very, very, very important thing. So when I joined my practice, these were my aims. Continuous improvement, adding super specialities at Aditya Jyoti. We had all the super specialities there. And here we had two. We had general and cataract and we had retina. So now we have added in oculoplasty, we have added in cornea, I do Botox. So these specialities and these departments have been created once I came in. Of course, I had a lot of time on my hand in the first 3 years since no one wanted to show me. So instead of just sitting around, I used that time to kind of add towards the administrative part of it. So improvements, expansion of the clinic, expansion of the layout, getting a modular OT, updating all the facilities, getting certifications and empanelments, and marketing and branding, which is something that I'm going to be talking about extensively in the next instruction course right here. Human resources, of course, you have to increase your staff. If there's one more doctor, you want to double your practice, because then there are two doctors who are drawing from that same practice. So you need to think about strategies of how you're going to increase. Super specialties was one of them. We expanded our clinic. We completely upgraded it to give it a completely different feel. We've bought a lot more diagnostic equipment now. We have to upgrade our EMR, our billing system. So one of the things I always tell people when they are starting a practice or they are upgrading a practice is, if you walk into a hotel that looks like this and they tell you the room rate is 15,000 rupees, are you going to pay it? No, you're not going to pay it. But if you walk into this hotel lobby and they tell you room rate is 15,000 rupees, you'll say, okay, this looks worth it. So your clinic needs to match what you are offering. Our practice is a premium practice. We mostly 99% offer premium cataract packages only, and that is why you have to match what you're offering. You don't have to have a swanky 5-floor building. You can even in 1500 square foot make your practice look very, very beautiful with just a few tweaks, keeping and maintaining everything, keeping a lot good housekeeping staff. These things are very, very important. Now, NABH is one of the things that we have done. My next aim and goals are CGHS and ECHS, which I know a lot of people will roll their eyes at because they don't pay. But ECHS, CGHS, for me personally, as a junior doctor at this stage, I feel will, you know, benefit me because I will get a personal patient flow. So this is something that I am pursuing. Insurance tie-ups and empanelment are very, very time-consuming. So now that there are two of us who are on the partnership of the clinic, I can give more time to do this. A little bit about NABH. I just want to tell everybody, you can have a small 600 square foot clinic as well. You can have a 5-story clinic. The point is, it is not as hard as you think. The bottom of that triangle in NABH is patient safety. And let me tell you that if you have patient safety as your number one priority, that is protecting you yourself. Today, with all the lawsuits out there, with all the media, with doctors constantly the victim of everything, you need to anyway prioritize patient safety. So there is not one single thing in NABH, in the manuals, in their guidelines, which is against you. Every point that they make you do is actually saving you. Once you open that rule book or the guideline book, you'll realize that this is actually beneficial to you, and this is going to actually help the running of your clinic. So the running of our clinic, whether you want to believe it or not, has actually become smoother after we got pre-entry level, because documentation makes our lives also easy. Yes, the first 5 months were an absolute challenge. Our staff, we, everybody just wanted to scream and yell and fight with each other. Emotions were running high, tempers were running high. There was paperwork. We didn't know where to keep it, you know. But now once it's gone into the flow, it's been very, very smooth. You can employ a consultant. There are so many workshops that are done. You can get in touch with me. I can help you if you like. The main thing is always start with paperwork first and then look at that. Pre-entry level does not require you to do too many structural changes. So don't be afraid of it. Think of it as your friend and just take the plunge. Other things that you need when you are looking at a practice and before you apply for NABH, there are very important documents. And this is an argument that Karishma and I have been having since a month. Bombay Nursing Act registration or relevant registration. In my opinion, any medical practice, or from what I understand, any and all medical practices should be having a registration, irrespective of whether you are operating or not. Because the Nursing Act says that if you are treating a patient, treating includes diagnosing and dispensing of drops, then you should have it. But I believe in Bombay, a lot of people don't because they don't have an OT. Without that, you will not get your biomedical waste registration. You will not get your pollution control board certifications. For NABH, you must have a fire NOC. And this has also been very, very useful. There is a doctor in Pune who had a fire in his building. And because of the fire standards put there because of NABH, the whole building was evacuated in no time. So it's like I said, it's beneficial. Don't look at it as your enemy. Drug and pharma licenses, I think we've already touched upon, and all medical council registrations for doctors, which is not only for your NABH, it's also always protective. So please register yourself with all the councils, MCI, every single council. It's a very small amount because it will protect you. If you need legal help, if you are in trouble, these councils will actually protect you because you are a member of them. Now, patient focus is something that everybody needs to think about. Patient is king, patient is always right. And when there are more people in a practice, you can dedicate more time with the patient. I sometimes spend 1 hour of counseling with a patient. I'm not joking. And this is only possible because there are other consultants or someone else is seeing patients. Otherwise, if everybody sits with for one hour with a patient, you know, you'll be sitting there for 16 hours a day. And feedback is important. NABH also asks compulsory for a feedback form. But even if you're not going for NABH, make a feedback form and take feedback from your patients. Make a visitor's book, take feedback from your patients. Not only will this help you to continuously improve yourself, but that feedback, when it's positive, you can use it to market yourself even further. You can post it on your Facebook page or you can post it on your website, and that also helps with brand building and marketing. Change is the only constant, and if you cannot accept that, you will not grow in any way. You have to constantly be prepared to change and upgrade and update yourself. Like I said, building trust with older patients is as important as creating new relationships. The next gen additives that I have brought into the clinic personally is listing us on all the sites like Practo, Just Dial. Listing doesn't mean you have to pay them money. Money is involved, and they will come and poach you because that is their strategy, is to get you on top of the listing as a sponsored listing. But that is beyond the gray area of advertising. So technically, MCI guidelines, you are not supposed to be paying. So being listed is one thing, but paying to be sponsored on top is actually against the guidelines. Social media marketing, everyone should create a Facebook page. It's free, it's easy. You have a personal Facebook page. So it's so easy to just create a clinic or a hospital Facebook page and start updating. That should be your starting step, even if you don't have a website yet. Your Facebook page will show up at least if someone, you know, types. And search engine optimization, if you have a website, if you're building it, do not make a website without doing SEO. There is no point. You must have search engine optimization, and I have a detailed talk in this. If you are interested to learn about it in detail, please stay on in this hall for later. Create a brand. So what is unique to you? What is your USP? What is your selling point? For us, it's premium practice. For me personally, it's the fact that I spend a lot of time with patients. So even if I have premium practice patients who still don't want me personally to operate them, they will still only want to talk to me. So I am doing the talking. Someone else is doing the operating. It doesn't matter. We are working for one center. We're working for one clinic. It's not about who's getting the cutting. It's about growing as a brand. It's about growing as a clinic. And that is okay. So this is how I marketed myself in these past 5 years. I did a lot of rural screening camps. I run a free charitable OPD in a Gurdwara near us. So I get a lot of free patients. So this keeps me in touch. We piggyback some free patients onto a paid list. We don't charge them, or we charge them nominal 1,000 rupees just to cover kind of their anesthetist cost, just so that my surgical experience in the beginning continued. And this is something that you have to do unless you get some kind of a tie up with a charitable trust. I held events, lots of rallies, glaucoma awareness cycling rally we did last year. It got a lot of attention. I got a lot of personal attention. People were aware that there is someone called Dr. Samita Mulani who exists, because no one knew me, no one knew that I existed. They only knew my father. We did an eye donation drive. I continue to do women empowerment workshops. So the thing here is you don't only need to do ophthalmology related things to get known. Once you build yourself as a brand or your name is out there, it's out there in the media, people are talking about you, you've created a buzz, then they get to know, oh, she's also an ophthalmologist. So sometimes it doesn't have to be that your identity is going from as an ophthalmologist. You can also work the other way. You can do other things. Like I work on a lot of women empowerment, so that is something that I got known through. And this is all the media attention that we got through all these events, and it was a real success for me. And the whole thing is create a buzz. So whether you're in a small city, medium tier city, level one city, you have to create a buzz about yourself and your name. So you need to create that brand. And just to show you, I actually did a fashion show. This is me in the blue. Just for that, because this was a fashion show which was featuring 20 of the top powerful women of Pune. And someone invited me, and I didn't want to lose that chance, because again, brand building and creating a buzz about yourself. So it doesn't always have to be you're being known for being an ophthalmologist. You can work around it. So the take home message is you need to hit the floor running no matter where you are, whether you're going starting from scratch, whether you're joining your current practice. Be very, very patient. Don't lose hope. Your patients will not trust you initially. They will eventually. So be patient. And there is only one way you can go, and that is up. So just hang in there. Thank you.